Well, I should just leave now. I can't possibly live up to that. Henry also warned me not to try to thank everybody individually, because I'm so grateful. I'm so happy to be here. I've been treated so well. I wanted to stay on and eat barbecue and just and just enjoy Kansas City. So, but let me more formally thank the Truman Library Institute and the Kansas City Public Library and all the people who've really made this really, really fun for me and really interesting for me. And I hope that I can, I hope that this talk is similarly so. Can you hear me? I feel like I'm hearing an echo, but maybe it's just my imagination. Is it, maybe the live, is this better? Okay. Anyway, people ask me why I actually wanted to do this book. And I've just always been sort of, ever since I was a kid, I grew up in Washington. And even as a kid, I was sort of fascinated. I would go to Griffith Stadium, the old ballpark, and I would look down from the upper deck, and there was Vice President Nixon, who was a real baseball fan, sitting right behind third base. He always had pretty good seats, and it was part of my childhood. And I always thought, how on earth could these two men have gotten together, and what would I find if I started going into it? And I hadn't even planned to, and this sort of came out of a conversation with my editor at Simon & Schuster, and said, yeah, for about 25 years, I've always wanted to do this. I've always wanted to do this subject. So I went into it, and I had no idea what I was getting into. I'm going to talk with slides, but one of the things that also that struck me when I did this was a way to look at the entire 20th century. Eisenhower was born in Denison, Texas, but he moved to Abilene very young. And when he grew up in Abilene, he would see the veterans on the streets he would see were Civil War veterans. And Nixon was born in 1913 in Yorba Linda, and the veterans he would see were veterans of the Great War. And Nixon lived until 1994. He lived through the end of the Cold War. So it was a way to look at the entire 20th century through these two men. And they really had a lot to say about what happened in the 20th century. So I was just drawn to it, and I was also drawn to it because of the huge differences between the two of them. When you look at their I'm not going to go into their childhoods at great length, but when you look at the houses they were born in, I was sort of struck by the similarity. Part of it is the fact that Ike's house in Abilene is on the grounds of the Eisenhower Library, and Nixon was very much influenced by that. And Nixon's, the house he was born in, on the grounds of the Nixon Library in Yorba Linda. The first line of his autobiography, RN, is "I was born in the house my father built," and that's the house. The first time, this is June 1945, and this is when Eisenhower. I'm sure you're all familiar with this moment. This was after the war. The Germans had surrendered unconditionally. Eisenhower, who had been the supreme commander of the Allied forces and the man who had directed the Allied expeditionary force in the invasion of Normandy, he was coming home. He'd had a parade the day before in Washington, where about a million people turned out. And in New York, four million people turned out to see him, and he was standing up, and you can see his, it's hard to see from the, but his sort of characteristic wave, the two arms extended with V's. And one of the people in the crowd, not on the ground, way high up, was Richard Nixon. Richard Nixon was in the Navy. He was a lieutenant commander, and he was finishing up his service. He was working, sort of ending, closing out defense contracts with the Navy. And he always claimed that he never forgot this moment, that he could feel Ike's magnetism from way high up. But in any case, he was there. And Eisenhower was being already talked about in terms of a presidential future. People were talking about what he might do. In fact, he was planning at that time to stay in the Army. He became chief of staff. He went back to work in post-war Europe. Nixon, who was older than most veterans, Nixon was 32. He was married, and if, I imagine he saw his future as going back to Whittier to keep up his law practice. But then he got a chance, which I go into at great length in the book, to run for Congress, and he just grabbed it. Even though the odds were long, and he was going to be running against a very popular five-term incumbent Democrat. And this, what he had going for him was he was young, he was married, he was a veteran, and he started to make the red issue, the the communist issue first began to sort of show up. And this was 4 years before Senator McCarthy was making a big, had a breakthrough with this issue. But Nixon used it well. But he used it. He used it by saying that Jerry Voorhees, he never called him a communist, but he said that one of his political action committees had been infiltrated. And Nixon got a great deal of help from a man named Kyle Palmer, who was the epitome of the biased press. He was the editorial page editor of the Los Angeles Times. He was the political editor of the Los Angeles Times, directed their coverage, and he wrote a column called The Watchman for the Los Angeles Times. He loved Richard Nixon. He just loved him, and you could just read the coverage today, and it was just one love letter after another, and I think that possibly more than anything else helped Nixon win by a pretty good margin, and he was on his way, and he ran again in 1948 without hardly any opposition at all, and in 1950 this is where he first met Ike, and here's a picture that it's not in the book, and I don't know it's ever been seen publicly before. I found it in Palo Alto at the Hoover Institute at Stanford, and it's not in the book because you couldn't tell who was who probably. But on a big screen like that, I can show you who's who. The head of the table, that's Herbert Hoover, who was the last living Republican president, and he was called the chief. And this is at the Bohemian Grove. Hoover loved the Bohemian Grove. He called it the greatest men's party on earth. And on his right is Dwight D. Eisenhower. By then, had become president of Columbia University and was really being talked about as a possible candidate in 1952. Three places down is Richard Nixon, who was running the nastiest campaign of his life against Helen Gahagan Douglas. And that year, the red issue was really, really being used. He said she was pink right down to her underwear, and that's when the term "Tricky Dick" sort of made its way into the political discourse, and it followed him forever, ever on. She didn't actually coin it. It showed up in some ad, I think from a union somewhere, but Mrs. Douglas never let it go. But this was their first meeting. And what's also interesting is that I don't know who else was at the table, none of them ever wanted Eisenhower for president. This was a fairly conservative group, and they wanted Robert Taft, the senator from Ohio, who much more appealed to them. Nixon won his race, and he won it by a huge margin. The only person who got more votes in California that year was Earl Warren, who was running for governor. And Eisenhower was being continually talked about for president by both parties, incidentally. The Democrats wanted him on their ticket, the Republicans wanted him on their ticket. Eisenhower was in the Army. He hadn't declared any political preference. Senator Douglas of Illinois came up with this novel suggestion that both parties could nominate Eisenhower, and then they could have different vice presidents, and that didn't happen. Eisenhower he declared he was a Republican in January of '52, and his first primary was in March against Senator Taft. He was in shape in Paris. He didn't bother to show up, and he beat Taft, and that was he was on his way. The Republicans did not want him. He was an interloper, heretic. They weren't sure what he was, but people loved him, and people like Nixon saw that he was a winner and would win, and here they are. This was 1952. Eisenhower was basically nominated by acclamation, even though there was some sort of dirty tricks at the convention. But Eisenhower had very good advice from Senator Henry Cabot Lodge of Massachusetts, and Tom Dewey, who was the governor of New York and had lost the presidency twice, as you all know, most famously in 1948 to Harry Truman. They were also the ones who had really urged Ike to take Nixon, and Ike really didn't know him. Ike hadn't lived in America very much. Ike didn't really know politics very well, but Nixon had a lot going for him. He was 39 years old. He was a veteran. He was from California, which gave a balance to the ticket, and he was a big red hunter. He'd made his reputation in the House by when he was on the House Committee on Un-American Activities, and the only one they really kind of nailed was Alger Hiss, and that was Nixon. So that was the ticket, and everything looked like it was going to be going great. They were going to coast to victory against Adlai Stevenson. Here was their big, one of their great slogans, a great poster, "Let's clean house with Ike and Dick." And by cleaning house, they were talking about Harry Truman and all the Truman scandals, which were pretty. Harry Truman himself was never really implicated in them, but he was surrounded by a lot of sleaze, and there were 5% kickbacks, mink coats given to a stenographer in the White House, deep freezes were being handed out. I think one of them went to Bess Truman, but no one really cared because the thing broke down. But it was clean. Let's clean up the mess in Washington, and that was a pretty effective thing, and that was going pretty well in early September, and then this thing came out. This is the New York Post. The story, as you can see, the DNA of the Post, even though it was a liberal Democratic paper then, now it's Murdoch Republican, the DNA of the Post hasn't changed at all. And the story that you want to look at is not the big headline, but the one above it, which is Secret Nixon Fund. I'm going to go through this pretty quickly because it's a fairly familiar story. It wasn't much of a fund. It was either $16,000 or $18,000. But the secret group of millionaires wasn't all that secret. Nixon had been asked earlier about it and gave the name. A man named Dana Smith in Pasadena was doing it. But nevertheless, it didn't look good, and it followed him around, and it became a complete story, a fascination for the press. And Eisenhower, who was running this campaign to clean up the mess, well, he wanted Nixon off the ticket. He really wanted him gone, and he let it be known through advisors and others that Nixon should resign. He never told Nixon that, and it was finally agreed that Nixon was going to speak to the nation. And this was the famous, this became known as the Checkers speech, in which he began, "My fellow Americans, I come before you as a candidate and as a man whose honesty and integrity have been questioned." And he went on at great length, baring his financial soul, talking about his mortgages, the car, how much he owed his parents, what his houses were worth, mortifying Pat Nixon, who was sitting next to him, and ending up with the most famous, the thing that he's most remembered for, which was to say, "I was given, one thing we were given was this a black and white Cocker Spaniel, and my daughter Tricia, like all kids, loves dogs, and she named it Checkers, and we ain't going to give it back." So that was, and that became the Checkers speech. And it was, but what really Eisenhower saw how effective it was. Apparently they were watching this in Cleveland, Eisenhower and Mamie Eisenhower. Some people were sort of weeping. It was a very effective speech. People laugh at it today, but it was an extraordinary piece of political oratory. And the thing that really got to Eisenhower, was that Nixon did two really, really rebellious things. One, he said, write to the Republican National Committee, as if it wasn't Eisenhower who was in charge of picking a vice president, but the RNC. And that really annoyed Eisenhower. And the second thing was, he said, "I think everyone should release their finances." And he seemed to be referring to Stevenson and Stevenson's running mate, but he was actually also referring to Eisenhower, who and Ike knew that he had gotten a huge tax break on his memoirs, Crusade in Europe, and he should be treated as a capital gain, not as income. So it was annoying on several grounds. And Nixon won. Nixon discovered that the five-star general, when it came to political combat, he really wasn't up to what this Navy lieutenant could do. And Nixon won. Nixon lasted him. They got together for golf. And this was after they became the administration was formed. Eisenhower began to bring him into things, and he did a huge favor for Nixon. He sent him on a trip to Asia. Now this stamp of Ho Chi Minh is a great stamp. Nixon did not meet Ho Chi Minh, but he visited a lot of the countries in Asia. In Vietnam he saw the Emperor Bao Dai. When I was at Yorba Linda, I found some of these amazing journals he kept, and I was able to use them. Some of them had a sort of stream of consciousness, which I'm not sure I'll have the chance to get into here. But at times when he was under great stress, he would have these inner dramas he would write out. In this case, he was really pretty perceptive, and he could write down things for himself that he didn't dare say. One of them was that if Bao Dai isn't very effective, if anyone can run this country, it's probably the communists. Which he didn't like. But in 1954, the year after he made this trip, there was a big push to get Eisenhower involved in helping the French in the Indochina War, and Nixon was one of those who was urging that. Eisenhower in his very clever way, and Eisenhower was very good at doing what he wanted to do without ever saying it directly. In this case, he made conditions impossible to get into this war. He said, well, we'll talk to Congress. And knowing that Congress had no desire to get into a war, and he said, we'll consult with our allies. And he knew perfectly well that Churchill wasn't going to bail out the French Empire after watching the British Empire being dismantled. And there were other reasons why Churchill. So Ike sort of plotted against himself and kept out of the Indochina War. There are certain parallels. I did a blog for the New Yorker on the certain parallels with what Barack Obama may be doing with Syria, the sort of calculated indecision about war. But in any case, Eisenhower knew he wasn't going to get into that war, but he did it while at the same time talking very tough, talking about the domino principle, and how the region was of transcendent importance. This is Eisenhower after his heart attack. This was probably the defining moment in their relationship. Nixon, people didn't think of vice presidents in those days as being presidential material. They were vice presidents. They were kind of a joke. They were throttle bobbins. To Eisenhower's credit, he brought Nixon he let Nixon chair the cabinet in his absence. Nixon was there for the legislative leaders meetings, the National Security Council. And he was in on things. Eisenhower was appalled at how little Truman knew when Roosevelt died. And he wasn't going to let that happen again. But still, there was no question that vice presidents were not considered heirs to the presidency. That really hadn't been the case since Jefferson and Adams. And the idea that Truman regarded Henry Wallace or Jack Garner or Harry Truman as presidents was preposterous. He didn't. These were placeholders. But suddenly, after this heart attack, and it was a serious heart attack, people didn't realize how serious it was at the time. It was a wonderful book, which I quote from in my book, just to sort of get some of the how serious it was. And I had a terrible medical care too. His doctor was smoking 4 packs a day during the war, and his doctor said, well, you know, if you cut down to 1 pack a day, you'll be fine. And Ike wasn't fine. He gobbled his food. That was an army habit. He smoked. By the time he became president, he had quit smoking, but he was not in great shape. So Nixon suddenly, after this heart attack, most people thought Ike wasn't going to run again. He was a 64-year-old man with a serious coronary. James Reston, the Times correspondent, basically said, "What an opportunity has fallen to a man so young to become an heir to the presidency." And that really made Nixon a target for everyone. So Eisenhower, and Nixon also understood that if Eisenhower didn't run in 56, then another nominee might not want him to be vice president again. So Nixon was already beginning to fret about his future, as you can imagine then. He was also beginning to worry about his behavior. He was getting counseling from people like Murray Chotiner, who had been advisors to him through his congressional campaigns and in 1952, and they were sort of advising him how to behave. And Nixon behaved really well. He didn't push hard. He stayed in the background. He took the responsibilities of vice president, not the president, and the government ran. And everyone was, the fortunate thing was that there wasn't anything really serious going on in the world. There were no big crises. If there was any real sort of territorial fighting going on, it was probably between Foster Dulles and Foster Dulles, what he imagined were the interests of Milton Eisenhower, Ike's beloved younger brother. But in any case, the government went on. One thing that changed, though, Eisenhower, of course, did decide to run again, and then Eisenhower decided he didn't want Nixon on the ticket in 56. And Nixon was faced with it once more. And I have these really, really excruciating details about what was going on there. Ann Whitman, who was Eisenhower's executive secretary, took amazing notes, and she sort of recorded everything. It began in January. I called him in and said, you know, Dick, I think you might consider getting some managerial experience. And he basically offered Nixon a cabinet post. He offered him Secretary of Defense. And Nixon, and then I forget what the other one was. He wasn't going to get Treasury, and he wasn't going to get Attorney General, and he wasn't going to get State. But almost anything else. And Nixon never knew whether Ike was serious or whether he just wanted to be rid of him. But Nixon knew that it would be perceived as if he was going to be dumped. And Nixon fought back again. I can't go into all the detail now, but it was an excruciating dance of sort of. Oh, I'm going to go, but you can imagine how it ends, of a passive-aggressive struggle between the two of them, with Ike saying, the vice presidency is not such a great job. And at one point he said, you know, He basically said, I might not live through my term, but if I do, there's not much for a vice president to do. And he really, really, really was pressing Nixon to get out. And Eisenhower also had another candidate in mind. The head of the Republican National Committee met with Ike on one occasion. They basically agreed that Nixon was going to go, and even so, it didn't happen. Ike wanted a man named Robert Anderson, who was the Deputy Secretary of the Navy, and Eisenhower just loved him. I don't know why. I've talked to people who knew him, and someone said, well, he was really good at meetings. Eisenhower could really appreciate a good briefing. He loved it, and that was one of the reasons actually that he actually had respect for Nixon. Nixon was a great in meetings. Nixon was terrific. He could listen to everyone and synthesize it all, and he was just a terrific meeting attender and synthesizer at the end. But apparently, no one was as good at it as Robert Anderson. So, but as you know, when all was said and done, Nixon was on the ticket again. And here is this picture, which is in the book, the picture says. It's less than it looks like, but in any case, there's Ike with his four grandchildren, Barbara Ann and David Eisenhower, and there's Nixon with his two daughters, there's Julie and Tricia, and David seems to be staring intently at Julie, but in fact, they knew each other, John Eisenhower, David's father, they lived out in Virginia, they didn't see each other very much. And Juliet had a black eye from a sledding accident, but that was enough to fascinate David at the time. Eisenhower got sick again. Eisenhower was really, I don't want to say I'm the first one because everyone knows it, but when you get into how frail he was very much like an invalid at one point. And in 1957, a really difficult time. The Little Rock integration crisis was going on. The Sputnik had been launched, and Eisenhower had a stroke. This was not an atypical headline. This was in the Boston Globe by a very sober columnist of the day, Doris Fleeson. And the headline is a little hysterical, but I'm sure you can see it. It was really Eisenhower had a minor stroke, but for one day he couldn't speak, and there was a lot of presumption that he simply wasn't able to be president, that he couldn't function more. One thing I go into in the book was a fascinating correspondence between a Supreme Court Justice, Felix Frankfurter, and William Rogers, who had become Attorney General, about succession. We didn't have a 25th Amendment then. And so what do you do? What is a president? What if Eisenhower asked himself, I'm president, and what if I'm really not very capable anymore? What if I can't remember things anymore? What if my stroke has really affected my ability to speak? How do we do this? Can I turn over some power, all power? And these were questions that had not really been explored. When Woodrow Wilson had his stroke Mrs. Wilson basically sort of began to run the government, but there was really no real thought to this. And Foster Dulles had already begun to do research about this after Eisenhower's heart attack. Very interesting stuff, they came up with a sort of improvised plan about succession of power and turning the presidency back and forth. But until the 25th Amendment, it would have been a very scary improvisation between the two of them. And by this time, Nixon was clearly had his eye on the White House, and there's the first debate, and he didn't have a chance. I mean, he really, on one level, even though the fact of the matter is that he very well may have won that election, but the reasons he didn't win are many, and I'm sure you know something Eisenhower said, something Nixon didn't do when in behalf of Martin Luther King, and then a lot of possible vote manipulation, some possibly in Illinois and possibly in Texas, but in any case, Nixon always thought it was stolen, and I think it really altered him in some way. He was actually surprised at how rough the Kennedys played. He had considered himself a friend of Jack Kennedy. They had offices across from each other. They'd come to the Senate at the same time. The Nixons were invited to Jack and Jackie's wedding. Jack Kennedy had asked Nixon to sponsor him for membership in the Burning Tree Country Club, and suddenly, Kennedy really went after him, and in a way that Nixon really wasn't prepared for it. So it was a really tough and embittering election, And I don't think Nixon quite recovered from it. And there's their farewell to Washington and the family. And they moved to California. They just thought that there was no point to staying there. Julie and Tricia, who were going to the Sidwell Friends School, a good school, finished the year. And the idea was that then Nixon, they would go back to California. They bought a wonderful house up in a place called Truesdale Estates, which is sort of north of Sunset in Beverly Hills. And Nixon was kind of bored. He was very bored. In fact, he said, "What do people do out here in California?" He wrote to someone. But then this thing came along. Well, why don't you run for governor? And Nixon had some very good reasons why he shouldn't run for governor. But finally, he basically got a push from Eisenhower, who he'd begun to see more and more regularly. Eisenhower was spending his winters after retirement. He was spending many winters in Palm Springs, and they began for the first time to socialize. It was the strangest thing. They never had much to do with each other. In Washington, Nixon was never invited to the private quarters. He never visited the Eisenhower house in Gettysburg, but he would go out to Palm Springs and they would golf. And I think Ike was bored, and Nixon I think welcomed the chance to sort of reacquaint himself with Ike, who he really admired and really wanted his approval. That sort of never went away. And so California, here they came, and he ran, as you know, he ran for governor. And that is getting ahead. He ran for governor, and he lost, humiliating loss. And that was it. Then he really was it. He decided he really was going to give up that life and move to New York. And he did move to New York. He got a job with a pretty good law firm, Wall Street law firm, and it was a very interesting time. I've actually talked to three of the partners who worked with Nixon, Len Garment and John Sears, who became a political advisor, and a man named Tom Evans, and they were all litigators with Nixon Mudge, which became Nixon, whatever it is, Nixon Mudge Rose Mitchell at the end, and he had a very happy life. His daughters were going to the Chapin School. Mrs. Nixon was delighted to be out of politics. She just couldn't stand it anymore. They would walk their dog Checkers along Fifth Avenue, and they would go to musicals, and they ran into Harry Truman one night. Truman did not want to shake hands for the cameras, but someone got a picture of them together. And everything was going well. And Nixon was going to be an elder statesman. He had an interview with Roscoe Drummond, who was a columnist for the Herald Tribune, and said, "Oh, anybody who thinks I'm ever going to run for anything ever again is out of his mind." And I think he meant it. He was going to sit back and watch Barry Goldwater and Nelson Rockefeller fight it out in 64, and to say he was going to be an elder statesman. And then this happened, and this thing happened, and nothing was the same after that. Within days, Eisenhower was very shaken by it, and he began talking about the assassination in Sarajevo, and he was sort of very un-Eisenhower in his first reactions. And Nixon began meeting with political advisors. Within days, he was meeting with Leonard Hall, the RNC chairman. And I have evidence, I have correspondence. Nixon really wanted to run again in 64. He quickly realized this wasn't going to happen, that this was going to be between Goldwater and Rockefeller. And of course, the party was terrified of a Goldwater campaign. Eisenhower was drafted to write an op-ed piece for the Herald Tribune, which was the mainstream voice, the voice of mainstream Republicanism. And Ike was, by the way, Ike, this time, this was 1964, and Ike was still doing pretty well. I talked to the editorial page editor of the Tribune, who went down to Gettysburg to work with Ike on this piece. I said, "So what was he like then?" He said, "He just goes all five-star on you." And Eisenhower was always very five-star with people. There's no question about it. But then Nixon was basically into it, and he could sort of already begin to see over the next hill to what was ahead. He knew that Goldwater was going to lose, and he also worked hard for him, and building up credit. And he also began to work for the election of a Congress in 1966. He really questioned Johnson's handling of the Vietnam War. Eisenhower really questioned Johnson's handling of Vietnam. They did this privately. They were sort of appalled by the way the country was going. And to say Nixon really began to sort of look ahead, and he could see ahead to 1968. He could see himself running again, or this comeback that no one thought was possible. After California, ABC had done a program called The Political Obituary of Richard Nixon, and And even Alger Hiss appeared on the show, but he was not done for. And meanwhile, the other thing that drew me into this story, I had mentioned this whole 20th century, the novelist side of me sort of loved the family story. Here are these two men, the Supreme Commander of the Allied Forces, 62 years old, the Orange County Senator, and who didn't particularly know each other, didn't particularly like each other, they didn't dislike each other. And in 1966, Nixon's younger daughter, Julie, who was going to Smith, began dating or seeing David Eisenhower, who was going to Amherst. David just hitchhiked up to say hello, basically, and they felt completely in love. They were totally crazy about each other. And I'll tell you, 44 years later, I think they still are. They were 18 years old, and that was it. That was it for both of them. That was the love of a lifetime. And a year later, they basically became engaged, and discombobulated everyone. Nixon, of course, began to worry, would this be seen as some political scheme to help him, having an Eisenhower in the family? And Eisenhower really wanted David to have a career first before he got into a marriage at that young age. He wanted David to be a lawyer or a doctor. They all liked Julie. Julie was a total charmer. Mamie was particularly fond of Julie, and Ike was too. But he really was worried about David's future. So then Dixon got nominated, as you know, and Eisenhower finally, after painful appeals by awkward appeals from Nixon and particularly a man named Bryce Harlow, who had been an advisor to Eisenhower and knew Nixon. He endorsed him at the last minute, though it probably didn't make any difference at this point. The Republican Party in 1968 was okay with Nixon. Their hearts were not with him. Even in 1968, their hearts were with Ronald Reagan, who had become governor of California just 2 years earlier. But they knew one when they saw one, and that's what they really wanted. But it wasn't going to happen. The biggest rounds of applause in Miami that summer of 68 were for John Wayne and for Ronald Reagan. Anyway, Nixon got the nomination, and this is the last time, I say last straw, this was the last time Eisenhower was seen in public. This was on his 78th birthday, and you'll notice the flag he's waving from the window at Walter Reed. It's not the presidential seal, it's the five stars of the five-star general, which title he wanted to keep, and that was the last time, that was the last time he was seen in public. There's Nixon in November. And you'll notice that the upstretched hands with V's are not unlike the way Eisenhower was looking in 1945, coming back from the war. Nixon, this became a regular Nixon trademark, but I think it was influenced by Ike's gestures. This is November of 68. December 68. They got married. They're 20 years old. Insane. But they had a huge wedding, and it was maybe the last sort of really happy time for all of them in many ways. I don't know if this was the last time that President Nixon visited General Eisenhower at Walter Reed, but you can see how skeletal he already was. And if I think this was in February of 69, and it was in the book, there's a moment where Nixon talks about he basically saw Ike on his deathbed, and there's a scene that Nixon, I think it's a dream fantasy that Nixon came up with, but it's sort of the way he wanted them to say farewell to each other. And I think he wanted it so much that he wrote it as if it really happened. And I get into that. This is the end of the journey. Ike dies on March 28th, 1969. And General Eisenhower, he gets a four-day, there's a funeral that goes on and on, and he's buried in Abilene. President Nixon lays the wreath on the casket of Eisenhower. And this was, almost 24 years after he'd seen him from that building in Lower Manhattan. And that's sort of the end of their relationship, obviously. And I have an afterword in the book, but I had to deal with Watergate and Vietnam just to sort of say what happened to all the main characters. But this story between these two men in this period, when so much was going on in the Cold War, in nuclear testing, Sputnik, everything, this was the period in which they sort of never let up for both of them, and so that. People ask me what got. I basically said I had no idea what I was getting into with this, And I had no idea what I was getting into in terms of just having to deal with all these different factions. I thought, oh, well, I'll just go to the archives and it'll all be great. In Abilene, you know, they're totally professional. They were quite wonderful. In York Belinda, it wasn't quite so easy. York Belinda is a bifurcated situation. On one side, there are the professional archivists who work for the National Archives and Records Administration, NARA. And on the same floor in the basement of the building at York Belinda is the foundation, which celebrates Nixon as a prophet, a peacemaker. They're very protective of Nixon. It's almost as if he was alive still, and they're very very leery of anyone who really wants to criticize him. And things came to a real head when the archives put up an exhibit of a sort of interactive Watergate exhibit, and visitors could go in and sort of convict Nixon every day. They could click on Gordon Liddy or click on Bob Haldeman, and they hear the tapes, and so that really set off the foundation, and I had to deal with both of them. Obviously, the professional archivists were so easy; they were nice, they were helpful. The foundation, I had to persuade them to trust me, and they should. I think they did trust me, and I think they ought to have trusted me. I played fair in every way, but they knew I'd worked at the Washington Post for 12 years, and the Washington Post was not a On the other hand, when I was at the Post in Outlook, I must say, I don't know if I've told anyone this, but I was, when George Bush I was having difficulties with the Soviets, and we didn't think that he wasn't quite getting Yeltsin, the Yeltsin era emerging. So I said, why don't we get Richard Nixon to write a piece for us? Nixon was traveling around all the time in those days, and so, oh, he'll never write for us. But, so I picked up the phone, and I called Saddle River, and I don't know who I talked to. It was either Kathy O'Connor or Monica Crowley, who was one of his assistants. And they said, yeah, sure, he'll write a piece for you. And it turned out to be a really good piece. I'd edited it, and then I called back in the morning, and I was going to suggest some changes. It turned out he'd stay up late rewriting the thing. And apparently Brent Scowcroft had read it, really liked it, gave it to George Bush. So it may have actually had some influence. But I did let the foundation know about this to try to help. And they turned out to be really, really helpful. They basically were the gateway to people who didn't ever talk. One of them who was just terrific was Marge Acker, who was Rosemary Woods' assistant. But she was actually considered Rosemary Woods' Rosemary Woods. She was fierce and tough, and she was also a great witness. She was there for everything. She was there for the entire fund crisis. She was on the train with Nixon, and she was wonderful and just great, sort of great details, the things she saw, and so on. And so they were really able. And by trusting me, then I think that helped me. It took me a year and a half to get David Eisenhower and Julie to talk to me, and I would write these pleading letters to them, and I say, listen, I'm really not out to, you know, kick your father around anymore. That's been done enough, and I meant it. I wasn't about to do that. And also, my book's not about Watergate and all that. So I said, oh, God, they're never going to call. And one day my cell phone rings, and, hi, it's Julie Eisenhower. So I said, oh, this is great. And so I went down to Philadelphia. We had a four-hour lunch. And they were just delightful and really helpful. And David sort of speaks as an historian, and Julie was still a very devoted daughter. And I really sort of got, almost, I feel like I sort of knew them as people. After lunch, I walked Julie to the train, and we just... Julie never wanted to talk to me again, I should say, but not in a bad way. I would run into her and she would say, oh, I'd like to introduce you to so-and-so, and then she did. And she introduced me to lots of great people. One of them was Don Hughes, who was Nixon's military aide for all the years of his vice presidency. Another one, I went to a thing called the February Group, where all of the alums would show up. And she said, I'd like you to meet someone who worked with my father when he was in Congress. And I met a woman named Dorothy Cox Donnelly, who seemed very frail. And I said, well, let's, she said, oh, you can give me a call. I'd love to talk. I said, well, let's just talk now. I have a tape recorder. And so we talked for about 10 minutes. And she was really interesting about that time. And then she died a week later. When I called, she had been hit by a car and she had died. And so I was very conscious of time running out for a lot of the people I talked to. And I uh, And I ended up talking to about 70 people all in all, and having to deal with all these different archives. And say the Eisenhower people were really, really interesting, and I found an awful lot of stuff also in the Library of Congress, where I mentioned the correspondence going on between Felix Frankfurter and William Rogers, the Attorney General, when Eisenhower had a stroke, and that's all in the Library of Congress. And I went out to Salt Lake City because a woman named Fawn Brody had some remarkable interviews out there. Fawn Brody was determined to prove that Richard Nixon and B.B. Rebozo had had a homosexual affair. And it wasn't fair. It's not true, but you could hear her interviews, and she would always end them with, did you see Mr. Rebozo? When they went off together, what do you think they were doing? And there was just so this is sort of what went on, talking to Ed Nixon, I said, what was it like when you went to the inauguration, meeting General Eisenhower? And he said, yeah, it was great to meet Eisenhower, but my father was much more thrilled to meet Herbert Hoover. And so it was just these people were really fascinating. And in just the last 4 or 5 weeks, 4 of the people I interviewed for this book had died. And when I speak about time running out. One of them was Peter Flanagan, who had been a fundraiser for Nixon. One of them was Helen Thomas, who'd covered all these presidents and knew them very well and had watched them. One was Len Garment, who had been one of Nixon's partners at Nixon Mudge, his law firm, and then went to the White House to be an advisor. And then one was William Scranton. And I had no idea that William Scranton was alive when I talked. I mean, he very much alive. He lived in California. He was 93 years old. Extraordinary memory, and he was the one that Eisenhower had tried to persuade to run for president in 1964 to try to stop Goldwater. A really humiliating exercise for Scranton, who then got to see Eisenhower at his very worst. Scranton thought Eisenhower was going to come out for him. He arrives at a governor's conference at Cleveland. The phone rings and says, basically, Ike says, no, I'm not going to be involved in any stop Goldwater movement. And Scranton had to go on Face the Nation and go humma, humma, humma when they asked about running for president. But he was a really, really, really bright, honorable, a lot of people were really bright, honorable people. And I was impressed by so many of them. And I think we all miss people like that. So I sort of end the book with a question to myself. Counterfactual history is a bad habit. You know, what would happen if Kennedy had lived? What would happen if Nixon had won in 1960? How would things have evolved? And I wonder how things might have happened if Ike had lived more than 2 months into the Nixon presidency. The answer, of course, I don't know. But I sort of wonder to myself, would Nixon possibly not have gotten? Might Watergate not have happened? Would Ike have gotten on the phone and said, he apparently didn't call him Dick after the inauguration. He said, Mr. President, what are you doing with yourself? Get hold of this thing. Would that have happened? I don't know. But I like to think that Nixon, in his constant search for approval, would have imagined Eisenhower not approving of what was going on, and that might have had some influence. And I think Nixon always really missed him in the White House after he died. There's one quote in the book toward the end, and I say Nixon said, I really need this is when Nixon was president. I really need to tell the president something, and as if he had forgotten that Eisenhower was no longer president, that he was president, and it was sort of a sad thing. And it seems like how dare you write this? But if you turn to my footnote, I got it from Ed Cox, Nixon's son-in-law, who's married to Tricia. So I had a good source on that, and because Ed Cox heard him saying it. So it was really, Nixon never really got over Eisenhower and how important he was to him. Eisenhower certainly got over Nixon. Except that he really did want him to be president at the end, and it was sort of a vindication, and he also wanted it for David and Julie. And it's impossible to imagine how the history of this country might have been without these two. So I think that's about where I was going to plan to end up. I don't know if I've gone too long or too short, but I just, yes. But I'm happy to take questions now.